I'm standing in front of one of Colorado's 16 named glaciers, but according to scientists, there's only one or two active glaciers left in Colorado. But it gets more interesting because depending on how you define it, there may be thousands of active glaciers in Colorado right now.
Before I get blown off this mountain, let's zoom out and answer some basic questions. When you think of glaciers, you may think of the huge ice sheets covering Antarctica and Greenland. But did you know there are over 1,000 active glaciers across 6 states in the contiguous United States? We'll be talking about two kinds of glaciers in this video. For now, let's focus on Colorado's Alpine glaciers. These 16 officially named glaciers are located in northern Colorado, 8 of which are in Rocky Mountain National Park. To get a better understanding of Colorado's glaciers, let's take a closer look at Andrews Glacier in Rocky Mountain National Park. Colorado's Alpine glaciers are all located in high mountain cirques. A cirque is a small bowl-shaped valley often formed by glaciers. The small lakes found at the bottom of cirques are called tarns and are formed by glacial meltwater.
As I slowly walk up St. Mary's Glacier, let's take a moment and clearly define exactly what a glacier is. The simplest definition of a glacier is a mass of ice that slowly moves downhill. Snow accumulates over many years and compresses into ice. The weight of that ice causes the glacier to move downhill. By some standards, a glacier must also meet a minimum surface area, say 2 square football fields. Now that we know exactly what a glacier is and where they are located in Colorado, how can there be any confusion as to exactly how many there are? And why do I keep referring to 16 named glaciers? The USGS is a federal agency that maintains the official database of geographical features in the United States. That database classifies exactly 16 glaciers in Colorado. But I learned pretty quickly, Colorado doesn't really have 16 glaciers. Some of these headlines were kind of alarming. Are they real glaciers? Some don't qualify as glaciers anymore? And St. Mary's Glacier was never a real glacier in the first place? And maybe most alarming of them all, in search of Colorado's last alpine glacier? And that's when I decided to take my own journey to these glaciers to find what remains and if I, an amateur, could see any evidence of glacial movement.
If you've ever been to Rocky Mountain National Park, there's a good chance you looked up at Tyndall Glacier, nestled in the cirque below Hallett Peak. I wanted a much closer look, so I hiked up to an altitude of 12,000 feet where the Rocky Trail meets the alpine tundra. From there, I approached the edge, and finally, I could see Tyndall Glacier from above. It's clear the glacier has retreated almost all the way up the U-shaped valley it helped create, but up here in the thin alpine air, I was struck with awe and wonderment. It's late July, and I'm looking down at snow and ice. It's a feeling that's hard to describe. I knew my best chance for seeing evidence of glacial movement would be at a different glacier in Rocky Mountain National Park. My wife and I hiked to Andrews Glacier on a beautiful August morning. We passed clear mountain streams and incredible wildflowers, but the weather was fickle. After waiting out a thunderstorm and then a quick sun shower, the skies mostly cleared. There was only one problem. Our destination at an altitude above 11,000 feet was shrouded by clouds. We kept climbing with hopes it would clear by the time we arrived. The clouds were just above our heads, and we stopped to appreciate the view before finishing our climb. Oh man, not only was the glacier obscured by clouds, but the wind was ferocious. I was determined to get up close and look for evidence of glacial movement, so I walked along the shoreline of the tarn as close as I could to the glacier. I had hoped to see deep cracks in the ice called crevasses. These cracks form under stress and are proof of glacial movement, but the visibility made it impossible to see very far. I briefly considered climbing the glacier in search of crevasses, but I'm always cautious and I knew better than to risk my safety in these conditions. I still had one more thing to try though. I could try to look for evidence of finely ground particles called glacial flour suspended in the water of the tarn. I submerged my waterproof camera in the water, It was really cool, and the water was certainly cloudy, but I couldn't be sure if that was from the wind or glacial flour. As we descended from Andrews Glacier, I decided my next visit would be to Colorado's largest, Arapaho Glacier. Our journey to Arapaho Glacier begins in the city of Boulder, home to the iconic Flatirons and the red roof buildings of the University of Colorado. Just a short distance west and high in the Indian Peaks lies Colorado's largest glacier. Its meltwater provides drinking water to the people of Boulder. Of the four glaciers I visited while making this video, my visit to Arapaho was the most bittersweet. The last few decades have not been kind to this once grand glacier. Its rapid retreat is obvious, and there is uncertainty in the scientific community whether Arapaho is a glacier or now just a permanent snowfield. This photo from 1898 shows how mighty this glacier once was. Nevertheless, just hiking to these glaciers is a challenge, and it's still an inspiring sight to get your first view of one of Colorado's alpine glaciers.
During my research for this video, I learned about another kind of glacier called a rock glacier. Now give me just one moment to convince you why rock glaciers are definitely worth your time. There's thousands of rock glaciers in Colorado, and they're often hidden in plain sight. We hiked past this one earlier, did you notice?
Rock glaciers are often mistaken as a boulder or talus field, but they have more in common with alpine glaciers. The main difference is they are covered by rocks and have either a core of ice or a mix of ice and rock in their core. They even move slowly downhill, just like alpine glaciers. Because Colorado has so many rock glaciers, they likely contain more ice than all of Colorado's alpine glaciers. The thick layer of rocks on top of the ice make rock glaciers more resistant to warming temperatures.
And if all that wasn't enough, here's the story of how a rock glacier helped prevent a catastrophe in Rocky Mountain National Park just a few years ago. 2 years ago, the color of this lake suddenly changed from blue to a beautiful bright green. What happened up there 2 years ago? And how did a massive rock glacier help save the day?
Beyond Lake Haiyaha is the aptly named Chaos Canyon, a popular place for rock climbing. That huge mass of boulders is a rock glacier thousands of years old. In June of 2022, a massive landslide sent over 3 million cubic meters of debris racing down the slope of Hallett Peak and into Chaos Canyon. The only thing preventing that landslide from continuing into Lake Haiyaha and endangering more lives was that monster of a rock glacier which absorbed the energy and stopped the landslide in its tracks. Small particles of pulverized rock called rock flour flowed into Lake Haiyaha. These particles remained suspended in the water, turning the color to this incredible milky green.
So what have I learned from my journeys to Colorado's glaciers? I'm going to share my key takeaways, but first, two quick things. There's links in the video description to many of the resources I used in my research for this video. Check them out if you want to learn more. Creating this video was truly a labor of love. If you got any value from it, please let me know in the comments.
St. Mary's Glacier is a fitting place to wrap up this video. The glacier that isn't a glacier and probably wasn't even when it was classified all those years ago. It's true, many of Colorado's glaciers have retreated in the 21st century. Only a few of the original 16 named glaciers still show any signs of glacial movement, and that trend is likely to continue. Studying Colorado's glaciers isn't easy, even with today's modern technology. My hat's off to those early glaciologists who trekked high into the Rockies in the 19th century, and also to today's scientists who still chase the remaining ice nestled in Colorado's high mountain cirques. And there's much more to learn about rock glaciers, with their vast numbers, hidden ice cores, and their natural resistance to a warming climate. After all my hikes this summer to Colorado's glaciers and the bittersweet emotions I felt as I looked in awe across acres of ice and also witnessed evidence of their retreat, I've learned that these gems of ice deserve our appreciation. And you never know, a few of Colorado's alpine glaciers just might find the right conditions in those high mountain cirques to survive for generations to come. Interested in learning more about Wyoming's lesser-known mountains? Click here for the Bighorns, and here for the Snowy Range.